especially with globalization, with depending developing countries, depending on more developed countries, this gap of just rich and poor is forever growing. And one of the most prevalent ways that Pranav has said that he said from his interview is poverty. And especially because they're impoverished, they're desperate to make ends meet. And this is especially the case in Albania, and especially in Western Africa, where families are willing to give up their child to better the whole, but in reality, they never receive that payment, and that's just a continuation of child labor. But it's not only poverty that's the case, there's also other vulnerabilities. And even like in the UK, just a couple years ago, they found that a ring of women that were being run away, there were a group of men who would offer financial and emotional support and manipulated them. And they were never aware of this, but they were eventually exploited for sexual trafficking.
People brought into trafficking aren't always forced into it. Coercion is a huge part of trafficking. People who are vulnerable are easy prey for traffickers. Drugs and the idea of love are huge parts of this. Trafficking victims are stripped of any idea of having basic human rights. In the case of drugs, the traffickers are providing victims with drugs to keep them from leaving since they don't have the money to get the drugs anywhere else. With love, it gets trickier since victims won't see the problem with their significant other that's like 10 years older than them controlling everything they do. That's a big reason why some victims won't seek help. They don't self-identify themselves as trafficking victims. Another reason why victims might not seek help can be due to the fear of shame or self-blame because they ran away in the first place. And as I stated earlier, just a little over half of trafficking requires no movement across borders. And then sex isn't the only thing that brings traffickers money. Just last year, the industry made $150 billion. And even though like the use of trafficking victims is mainly labor, around 66% of the revenue from trafficking comes from sex. And sex brought in $99 billion last year.
So as you can see here, there were 74 cases reported in the state of Minnesota, and then there was 254 calls just this past year. And most of the purpose of the calls were to report a trafficking tip. Otherwise, calls usually consist of a victim reporting a tip or just to access service referrals. And then according to the Human Trafficking Center, in the private economy, more men are being trafficked for labor exploitation, and as for sexual exploitation, women are being trafficked more.
So we really found five main studies that really outline different subjects in human trafficking. So now, in the study of health concern, they said that exploitation is something that is commonly used by a lot of businesses throughout the world to have disposable labor forces. Now, the estimates are throughout the world, 29.4% of people who are in the workforce are estimated to be in a situation of forced labor or terrible working conditions that renders them useless afterwards in society. So the real problem you see is a lot of these people who are going into human trafficking, after they finish their labor or they can't work anymore, they really have a problem integrating themselves back into society and into the workforce because the labor that they did do isn't really effective towards getting another job, and they find a really hard time in order to move back into society. Now, in the Plain Sight study, Barry Koch, a former assistant director, district attorney in the New York County, said that the general public does not really have an awareness of the magnitude of the problem. Whether it's labor trafficking or sex trafficking, the number of victims is staggering, yet many of them remain hidden in plain sight. After drug dealing, trafficking of humans is tied with arms dealing as the second largest criminal industry in the world, and is the fastest growing. Raising public awareness is an important element in the fight against human trafficking. Now, really what this shows you is that trafficking, even though it doesn't seem like a really big problem, it's everywhere that you really can look. If you really look for it hard enough in these truck stops that we outlined earlier, or even in the Twin Cities during the Super Bowl, it's really everywhere, but people don't know much about it, and because they don't know much about it, people really ignore it. And they also said that there are 2.3 million work attributable deaths annually because of these forced labor, or these forced labor methods. Because there's so many forced labored people through human trafficking, it just goes to show you how much of a problem it truly is for people, not just in the US, but throughout the world, because they don't really know what's going on, and they can't integrate back into society. Now, the study from Stolen Smiles said that almost 1 in 5 women reported that a relative knew her trafficker. For some women, this was the case of betrayal by a family. For others, the relatives were acquainted with traffickers but were unaware of his or her intentions. Numerous women were recruited by a friend or an acquaintance. So what this really goes to show you is that, although you may not know what's going on or like what's going on around you with human trafficking, you probably do have a connection to it in some way or the other. It doesn't have to be like an immediate friend or immediate family member, but yeah, one of those people might know someone who's connected to it in some way or the other. Now, the study from trafficking in persons said that the data gathered on the genders of offenders in 46 countries suggests that women play a key role as perpetrators of human trafficking. In Europe, for example, women make a larger share of those convicted for human trafficking offenses than most other forms of crime. So the statistic really shows you that the common misconception is that males are the ones who are doing all the human trafficking, and you can't really trust that ideal, because the problem is countries like Europe, if females and males are doing it in such great quantities that you don't really know where you're going to get trafficked from or what's going on with you or what's going to happen to you. Now, finally, from the study, an overview. According to estimates by the United Nations agencies and major non-governmental organizations active in the combat against the phenomenon, over 70,000 former child soldiers have been involved in disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration programs since 1998, which really shows you that human trafficking is a world problem. Because so many children are trafficked day to day, not only in the US, but from Africa and Asia specifically, these kids are really robbed of a life that they can't, or of a childhood that they can't have back. They either die in a war somewhere, or they integrate back into society and can't get a job. Because what did they do before? They were working as a soldier. They couldn't do anything as a resume to go off of that. And they don't have any education to have a formal job in our society today.
So although human trafficking occurs all around the nation, the state that has the most trafficking is California, with 1,305 reported cases just last year. And then following California is Texas with 792 reported cases, and then Florida with 604 reported cases. In the United States, more than 40,000 total cases of human trafficking have been reported to the hotline in the past 10 years, which was found from the Polaris Project. And then $8 billion is saved annually by private households that employ domestic workers under conditions of forced labor. And then victims also spend an average of 20 months in forced labor, although this may vary with the different types of forced labor stated by Human Rights First. And then we also did a student survey with Eastview students, and 72.9% of Eastview students believe that young girls, which is 17 and younger, are trafficked the most in Minnesota. But actually it's adult women, which is 18 years and older. 43.2% of trafficked people in Minnesota are adult women, while 28.4% are young girls. It is least likely for men to be trafficked, although middle-aged men might be trafficked for labor purposes. The following recruitment methods are kidnapping, false job promise, false travel arrangements, false promise of marriage, and then the genuine promise of legal employment opportunities. All of these are recruiting methods except for the genuine promise of legal employment opportunities. Most Eastview students knew that this was not a recruiting method, but 15 girls and 13 boys believed that it was. And then as you can see, 4.6% of Eastview students believe that a child is considered a typical recruiter, but that is actually not the case. The typical recruiters include females, males, friends, strangers, significant other, and acquaintance. A child could possibly be a recruiter, but most likely they will be working with an adult.
So the most important thing we can do as citizens right now and to recognize human trafficking is to really know the signs of human trafficking. And it breaks down to really four categories. We have control, and that's if people have a lack of control, so this just in terms of like identity, personal possession, they don't have a control of their bank account, or they don't have even have control of the language, so they need a third-party translator. The next part is behavior. If they seem very anxious, depressed, or even scared, that's a telltale sign they might be human trafficked. Health is another one, the obvious one. If they seem abused in any way, or malnourished, or also the same thing if they're anxious or scared. And the last thing is work and living conditions. If they're working extremely long hours, if they're exclusively working off of tips, or where they go to work, if you ever see them, is like a very dangerous area, or it's really with like barbed wire, or especially if they're only working off of tips for future cases.
So some things that we can do to help human trafficking or help deter human trafficking is, as Kenny said, one of the biggest things we can do is recognize the signs of human trafficking so that we can help potential victims or help identify actual human traffickers, maybe. And another thing is you can practice self-defense. Self-defense can greatly deter a potential kidnapper. And Warriors Cove is a company here in Minnesota that actually holds a free 90-minute self-defense seminar for women over the age of 13. And they actually just held one in Burnsville. And another big thing is being conscious about what you buy. As a consumer, you may buy products like Nike, Apple, and those companies actually use child slaves to produce their products. So just being conscious of what you buy so you don't support those kind of businesses. And lastly, if you ever notice anything, you can call the National Human Trafficking Hotline.
Alright, so after hearing some like methods used for like recruiting victims, I'm gonna read two scenarios, one boy and one girl. And after I finish reading each scenario, I'd like you guys to kind of tell me like where you see like red flags or where they should have stopped. Here's the first one. My name is Melissa, and I'm from Phoenix, Arizona. A few years ago, I was working two jobs trying to pay my way through college. One of my jobs was a cashier in a mall near my house. While I was at work one day, a man came to my register and purchased his items. He's attractive, well-dressed, and charismatic. There was no reason to be suspicious of him. He said he was a modeling agent, looking for models in the area. He had a business card and everything. He told me that I was very beautiful and asked me if I would like to be a model for his company. I agreed to meet with him after my shift at work. He took me to dinner with a woman who he said was his wife. They told me they would need to take me to get a makeover and they would fly me to California for my first photo shoot. I got my hair, nails, and makeup done. Everything seemed normal and very exciting. They invited me back to their home for the photo shoot. When they started taking pictures of me with a disposable camera, I thought it was strange. They noticed it made me nervous, so they assured me that once we got to California, there would be a photo shoot with expensive equipment and professional photographers, but the trip to California never happened. So where do you guys like think she should have like stopped, or where do you guys see like red flags?
The moment when she went out to dinner with him,
She said that he had a business card, but she could have like Googled their organization name and like see if it's actually
like
real.
Something like that. Alright, so now I'll read the second one. I came to the United States from the Mexican state of Oaxaca. After Hurricane Katrina, I was offered a job with a subcontractor to help clean up all the mess, the houses, the trees, and everything. All that the wind had damaged and destroyed. We collected the trash from the streets. We cut up fallen trees, piling them in one spot. This is the type of work we were doing. It was a big, serious disaster, and there was so much cleaning up to do. Our boss kept a notebook with our names and all the records of our hours. We'd been promised $11 an hour. We worked every day, Monday to Monday, and the first 3 weeks we weren't getting paid at all. When we complained about this, the bosses would say, "It's fine, don't worry. I'm going to the bank right now." Then they would come back and tell us that the bank wouldn't give them the money, that we would have to wait. That's the excuses they gave us. We slept on cots at night in an airplane hangar on the base. After 2 weeks, they started to take away some of the cots. We didn't understand why. Some of us had to sleep outside. We didn't know what to do, and we worked it out according to who needed the cots most. The people on the floor had some blankets, but that was it. There was intense heat during the day and intense cold at night. Well, then the boss disappeared. We tried to find her so we could get our checks, but she was gone. After 3 days, the military men came. They came up to our cots, the few cots that we had, and took them. Then they shut off the bathrooms and kicked up like they were cleaning up the base. So where do you guys see it? Like some sketchiness? sketching the